These guys are getting settled here, so I won't take up any more of this time. I'd like to welcome to the stage a whole bunch of people. I'm going to let Paul Knight come up here and talk about more than I am. But I'm going to go, I'll start with going from the stage left side, Mr. Chris Henry. Mr. David Grisman. Mr. Mike Compton. Mr. Butch Waller. Mr. Ed Neff. And the wonderful Roland White coming to sit down for you. So this, as a mandolin player, this is a fantastic thing for me to be able to start. Everybody give a hand for Mando Madness.
Thank you. Well, here at the Mandolin Madness, here at the 40th year of the CBA's Father Day Festival, as usual, there's a lot of great mandolin players, and in particular, I think this year, we only have six out of the many great talented mandolin players at this festival, but these are six real important folks, and they agreed to do a workshop for y'all. And after hearing that, I'm nervous to talk at all because nobody's going to want anything but playing. But I thought I wanted to at least say a little something about every one of these folks. And I want to start off with the two gentlemen just to my left here, both honorary lifetime members of the CBA, Ed Neff and Butch Waller. They played a lot of bluegrass in California and brought a lot of bluegrass to folks all over the world from California, state of California, which is pretty cool. Ed, we're on Vern's stage, and how many folks saw the alumni Ed Williams band set? Really wonderful, real special for a lot of us here to see you guys back together again.
That's
two. And this, you know, you were with, you're actually in Butch's band before Vern, but Vern was in the 80s is when you were playing with Vern Williams?
Yeah, I think I started around 79 or 80, somewhere in there. I think I actually probably played a few gigs with Vern even when I was playing with Butch. There was not a lot of fiddle players around, so, you know, the few fiddle players that were around, we got a lot of work.
Yeah. And, you know, Vern Williams was originally from where? It was
Arkansas. Mountain View, Arkansas. He said he was from Frog Holler in Newton County.
And what kind of influence did he have on your playing? Anything particular?
Well, I mean, you couldn't have a better singer to play off of, you know, and that's when I played with him. I watched his, it sounds sort of funny, but I watched his mouth all the time to play, sync up with him and play along with him, and you know, my job is to try and help bring stuff together, lead chords, lead into chords, and you know, the fiddles, it plays a lot of backup in that. And so I couldn't have had a better singer to play off of, and you know, Vern's one of the three or four best tenor singers there ever was.
Mm-hmm. And I saw a great example of that last night at your set. It was really just beautiful to hear your backup and fiddle.
Chris did a great job of filling in for Vern.
Chris Henry.
Yeah. Vern played very straight. I used to say almost pre-bluegrass. It was, you know, he didn't play a lot of real Monroe-y, that kind of stuff. He played a lot of very simple, played the melody. You know, that's what we all kind of try to do.
I also want to mention that Ed has one of the only that I know of, maybe the only in Northern California, weekly bluegrass show. Willowbrook Ale House in Petaluma. He plays every Thursday night, and that keeps him pretty sharp.
It's 18 years we've been.
18
I've been
years.
There. You know, the band has changed.
That is fantastic.
Off and on, yeah. 18 to life.
I wanted to stay here for just a minute.
And then, well, it's appropriate that you're sitting right next to Butch Waller, because prior to Vern's band, you were in Butch's band, and that was we're talking 70s now.
That was the first, you know, full-on band that I was in.
And that's High Country.
And that was 69, I think I joined Butch.
And Butch, you started the band in 68, is that right? And you can swing the mic over when it comes time. But, next.
couldn't afford more microphones.
No, I'm sorry, I ran out of mics. High Country credited by lots of folks, and probably true, I think it is, your longest running, steady running California bluegrass band since 1968.
Most people got better sense, yeah.
Well, an interesting one point about that not everyone might know that, and I'm not sure the date of this, it was early 70s, I think, that you put out a couple records on a little-known label called Raccoon Records. And where were those recorded?
Those were recorded, well, the Raccoon was, you know, back in the late 60s, the record companies were giving every rock band that kind of did okay, giving them their own record label. Raccoon was the Youngbloods label. And so we recorded out at Banana Studio out there in Inverness. And we did two records. And they were distributed by Warner Brothers, so a lot of people got a hold of them.
That's what I think was unique about them, as being a subsidiary of Warner Brothers. Those records went all over the world, got great distribution. And I think you benefit from that. in your touring.
Yeah, I've run into people all over here and in Europe who said that was their first bluegrass record. Which, whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, I can't say.
Yeah, we've got good fan mail from South Africa. It seemed like it was better distributed throughout the world than it was in the U.S. And it wasn't, they only printed about maybe 5,000 the first one and 7,000 the second one. And they seem to have gotten around the world. I met a guy, came to Paul's Saloon that wanted to hear High Country. He bought our album in Spain, in Madrid.
They're $1.79 in Kmart now, if you're interested.
In the cutout bin.
We're open.
Well, that was Banana, Lowell Levenger from the Youngbloods, who chose to spend his royalty checks on bluegrass records, which was pretty cool. Dave Nelson from the New Riders also did that when he had a chance to, what would you like to do? He brings out Don Reno and Chubby Wise and Frank Wakefield to make some bluegrass records. So maybe not the wisest choice to spend your money, but I'm glad he did. On one of those records, you guys did a mandolin duet. We talked about that. What was that number?
Well, one of the ones we did was Bill Monroe's Moonlight Waltz.
Did you guys all want to join in on that? Is that a good one to...
Yeah. I'm sure that's one of the
wrong guys. More music, let's talk.
I would appreciate some cover. Thank you.
what happens when you put players like this on the spot. All right, well, since Mike is sitting next there, I'll just go right to you. Mike Compton, he's here with two bands this weekend, and if you came late, did you, anyone see the Jump Steady Boys? Did you get to see those sets? And then the Nashville Bluegrass Band. And so two different mandolin styles, I think.
Correct.
I don't know if you want to espouse on that at all. I want a little bit of your history, though. I know you also spent a lot of time with John Hartford.
Yes, sir.
So, again, music that's earlier than bluegrass and other than bluegrass. Is there something you want to demonstrate? Could you demonstrate something with just rhythm alone in terms of the two styles? Or?
Well, bluegrass, of course, is.
Slow down.
No, it's a little bit more than that. I'm just being a jerk. The old-time rhythm that I started messing with originally came about when I was doing some duet work with David Greer, and I found out really fast that whenever a guitar player plays lead, playing chop chords is virtually no support at all. If there's only two of you, there needs to be more going on. So it was a frantic search to find something to do just for survival. Mm-hmm. When I started working with John, he was in an Ed Haley phase. And Ed's wife, Ella, played a lot of rhythm with, I guess, most of his recordings. And she played two-finger chords a lot, just and real strummy things. So it's real easy chords.
Yeah. Would you, since you're already playing a little bit there, you're also one of the only people up here that tour as a solo artist on mandolin. Would you play a song for us? It's just a solo piece. And people can join if they'd like.
That would be a solo.
Yeah, I know. But I mean, after. Yeah.
Say again?
That wouldn't be a solo.
A singing tune, you know, whatever.
A singing tune? Okay. Let's see.
Of my notes. I didn't get the order right here, though, but we can jump right to you.
Jump away.
And David, for those of you who saw his set last night, you did a wonderful history of bluegrass, or leading up to bluegrass, which is just really fantastic. And, it kind of talks a lot about how Bill Monroe heard lots of music and had lots of influences and kind of put it together and came up with something that he could call his own, which is very similar to what you've done. lots of different influences and came up with a music that really couldn't be called bluegrass and had to have a new label, and he came up with dog music.
Well, you know, oddly enough, it started with really pursuing trying to play like Bill Monroe. I was actually at first trying to play like everybody that inspired that. And to me, there were around four mandolin players at the time I wanted to play like: Frank Wakefield, Bill Monroe, Bobby Osborne, and Jesse McReynolds. And I tried to learn everything I could. In fact, I remember Butch showing me some Bobby Osborne stuff.
My first squeeze.
Yeah. I remember you showed me how he played a break on Is It Too Late Now? You know? There's a lot to cover here, but I very early on met an incredible musician who was a neighbor of mine, Ralph Rinsler, who lived about four blocks away. And he was playing in the first bluegrass band in New York City, the Greenbrier Boys, great mandolin player and also a great musicologist. He, among other things, rediscovered Clarence Ashley and I was the first guy to record Doc Watson. And, he just was an incredible resource to go over his house. And there were three of us young misfits going to high school. And he turned us on to just all kinds of stuff, including Bill Monroe. And one morning in 1961, he called me up and said, "Hey, I'm going down to Rising Sun, Maryland today to hear Bill Monroe and the Bluegrass Boys. Want to come?" So naturally, affirmative was my reply, and so we went down to a place called New River Ranch, and just a small, maybe 150 seats, wooden benches, and stage, and there was Bill Monroe and his Bluegrass Boys, and there was also these parks, country music parks. There was another one, Sunset Park. They were about 20 miles away from each other. And they would usually have a local band opening the show. And that day they had a band called Frankie Short, Marvin Howell, and the Franklin County Boys. Well, they had a young mandolin player named Frank Wakefield playing in that band. And I got the... And in 1961, Frank was about as close to Bill Monroe as one could probably get. And I got the mistaken impression that they all sounded like that. The first two real bluegrass mandolin players I heard in the wild. And they both, and then to top it off, I heard them playing duets backstage. So that was very inspirational. And, a few years later, I made a pilgrimage during my Easter break from my first year in college to go down to Washington, D.C., where I heard that Frank Wakefield was playing with Red Allen, and I took my Wallen sack tape machine and my mandolin and walked into this little bar, no bigger than this stage, really, and I opened the door, and there they, Red and Frank, were sitting at the first table there. And Frank, they were very welcoming, and Frank took me home with him. The next couple of days, he would show me all kinds of stuff. And he actually had I don't know if it was painstaking, but he had learned all the Bill Monroe solos off of all of his records by, I guess, slowing them down. And he just started showing me these Bill Monroe solos, and kind of really got me started trying to figure out stuff off of records. And, I did that for a few years and ran into folks across the country like Butch. And, there were little pockets of musicians in different places, in Berkeley, California, Philadelphia, New York, Chicago, and sort of like-minded kind of urban young people that were interested in bluegrass music and mandolin playing, and so we'd meet each other, and I started, cause some of my friends got to work with Bill Monroe, Bill Keith, the banjo player, and I met Del McCurry back then, saw his first gig with Bill Monroe, and Peter Rowan and I became friends, and all us, you know, young folks. And I'd made a couple of trips, and I couldn't get a job with Bill Monroe because he wasn't hiring mandolin players. I was going to write a song called Everyone's Played with Bill Monroe But Me. But in any case, you know, I got to be, I started focusing more on Bill's style and really trying to understand even the way he was thinking about music. And he kind of liked that, but to a point, if you got too good at it, he would say, you know, you can play like me, now go get your own style. And that was really probably the most important lesson I learned from Bill Monroe. So, you know, and fortunately, this other, I started, because I noticed all of my heroes wrote original mandolin tunes, which I was learning, but I decided that was part of the package, you had to write your own tune. So I deliberately sat down and wrote my first tune, which I purloined a chord progression from Frank Wakefield from a song he wrote called Couldn't Leave Well Enough Alone. And I put a faster melody to it. And then I came up with some other chord changes for a bridge and made up my first tune, Cedar Hill. And which, you know, what does a Jewish kid from Passaic, New Jersey name his first bluegrass instrumental in 1963? You know, that's kind of, I got out a map of Tennessee. And found Cedar Hill, you know. And a couple of weeks later, I just wrote another tune kind of spontaneously. And I reached under the bed for that map of Tennessee, and I couldn't find it, so I called it Fanny Hill. Well, and, you know, I kept going, and we should turn it over to my senior member here.
We're gonna get there. I think maybe another tune is in order, because you mentioned Frank Wakefield, and we did mention Camptown Races. I don't know if you'd like to play that.
You guys play that in Camptown Races?
Yeah.
We could try that. Yeah. Can't play it like I do.
Well, he mentioned different, they don't all sound the same here, do they? You can hear the different styles. You might not be able to see who's playing it all, but you can hear the different styles of each one of these folks. Well, now we want to talk a little bit about someone we're really fortunate to have here. He was here, I think, last year with his own band. Roland, were you here last year? Were you here last year with your own band?
Yeah.
Yes. And now he's here with a reunion of sorts of the Kentucky Colonels, which is something really special. You're fortunate to see it here. You won't probably see it again, maybe. And it hasn't happened. When is the last time you played with all these folks that you have up here?
Well, let's see, Roger Bush, I hadn't played with him in maybe 40 years or more. Let's see, who do we have? Herb Peterson, I played with Herb Peterson a good bit.
Quite a bit.
Let's see, who else we have? Patrick Sauber, I played with Patrick Sauber a whole lot in different configurations out here in California. And let's see, who else is in the band?
Leroy
McNeese, yeah, I played with him a little bit one time at Andy Griffith thing.
TV show.
Well, the TV show, but they have a Mayberry Days in North Carolina.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Somewhere out there. Yeah.
We're so glad you got them together for this festival, the 40th
anniversary festival. Yeah, I was really glad that they could all do it. Yeah. I really wanted Roger one thing, and because Patrick.
Yeah. Well, I love about it when he came up and to your bass player, being a fellow bass player, is he had one string on that bass that must be 40 years old. It's the same string.
Yes, it is.
It's a Red O'Ray, and it's been there ever since I saw him first time. Anyway, Roland is, of course, originally from Maine, right?
Right.
And but pretty early on, got down to Southern California.
Yeah, 1954, I was 16 years old.
All right, and then the Kentucky Colonels started, or the roots of it.
Well, yeah, that was, we had a little group, a family group, called the Country Boys. It's Clarence, Eric, and myself. And we won a talent show when we got out there, and they put us on TV. So we played this TV show for a while, and then we gave it up because it was such a long ways, and before all the interstates, and we had to leave at 2 in the afternoon to be there by 5:30.
Wow.
So we gave that up after several months, you know. And then we had different musicians join us and stuff, and then it wasn't until, but shortly after we got to California, I had one of my uncles who came out to hear us play at the house after arriving in California. And he lived in Burbank also. And we played a couple tunes for him, and there wasn't bluegrass, ragtime, ain't soldiers, joy. Tunes my dad played on the fiddle. And he said, Roland, did you ever hear Bill Monroe? I said, well, no. He says, well, he's a mandolin player, he's on the Grand Ole Opry, and he's fast. Okay, because we play like a... And just like that. So I went to the local store there in Burbank, Karate Music. And they didn't sell any, in fact, my dad had just purchased a guitar, the first D18 we ever had, flat-top guitar. And so down there I says, where can I buy some records? He says, well, I've got a catalog here, I'll do this real quick. So I went through the catalog, and I said, what are you looking for? I says, Bill Monroe, he's probably in there if he's on a major label, and he was. So I looked it up, and I came across a couple of things called breakdowns. And we didn't have any tune called breakdowns. Ragtime breakdown, So I says, well, what's the breakdown mean? He says, well, that usually means the fast instrument. I says, well, I want that one. And it was the Pike County breakdown.
Wow.
So it came in a couple weeks later, and we took it home. My dad bought a little record player, just the record player, Magnavox. And it played 45s and 78s and LPs. We put that thing on there, and it just changed our lives. It was just like, whoa, wow, how can they play so fast? So we started there, and then I kept ordering some more records, and then the guy at the store says, you know, do you get the country music song Roundup? You know, these magazines that had lyrics to songs, and, you know, it's on the back cover of that. It's all kinds of music. He says, string band music, he called it. And so I says, yeah, you know, we had left a lot of them in Maine, but we purchased a couple. So I look back there, and here's Bill Monroe, Flat Scruggs, never heard of Flat Scruggs, Standard Brothers, Country Gentlemen, you name it, you know, McCormick Brothers. You know. So if you bought four records, you got one free. So I ordered every record on there. It took me about 2 years. I still have them all. And I just started, we started listening to bluegrass music, you know, that way and learning it, you know. And then in 1958 or maybe 59, I think is when Billy Ray joined us. and he played the five-string banjo, and we had a bluegrass band. Yeah. We could never have a fiddler, because there weren't any fiddlers. There were fiddlers. My dad wouldn't play with us because he didn't play that kind of music. But there weren't any fiddlers out there in Southern California that could play that stuff. Yeah. So we just did without a fiddler for years. We just went on from there.
Yeah, and you, so you're playing locally around there, and you had a, did you some radio shows too?
Yeah, we did some. It was a radio show in Ontario, California, okay, that we were on every Saturday afternoon.
And I think that what a lot of people consider the big break, or at least an interesting one, was when you were called to play on the Andy Griffith Show.
Yeah.
And that's in the 60s, right? Mid-60s? Or
1961.
And you weren't called the Kentucky Colonels then, or?
No, we were called the Country Boys.
Okay. And is that what they called you on the show?
Yeah, that's the name that... When we got on a TV show, the guy wanted us to have a name. When we won a talent show, and he said, well, you have a name? I says, well, I'm Roland White, I don't know what it is. No, a band name. He says, it's all new to us, you know. He says, no, a band name. I says, no, we don't. He says, well, how about the Three Little Country Boys? Okay. So.
Well, I'm curious now. So I know I heard from Leroy McNeese's little story about him being in the band and being on that show, and then I know you went out and toured outside of California, right?
Well, it wasn't until, anyways, in 61 we did that show, Andy Griffith Show, and then they called us back later on that year, and it was the day that I was going to John F. Kennedy was elected president. He drafted everybody, so I got drafted. So I went September 24, 1961 to 63, September. Anyways, and when I came home, they'd recorded an album without me. It was called Bluegrass America. And that's where the name came. Merle Travis and Joe Mafis produced the album, got it together. And Merle Travis didn't like the Country Boys because it was too generic. So he says, how about the Kentucky Colonels? So the rest is history.
Let me ask you a question, Roland. It seems, to the best of my recollection, the first time I heard you guys in when you came to Gertie's Folk City, you were called a country boy.
We may have been, let's see.
But that wouldn't have been...
No, that was 1964, 63.
63.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just so right after I come out of the Army. Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, we were called the Kentucky Colonels. Because, yeah, we had...
And you must have toured, well, I'm sure everyone here probably remembers when they saw, you folks must have seen the Kentucky Colonels, you came up to the Bay Area. And...
Yeah.
A couple of times, yeah.
You never get to see.
I saw a reunion show at the Ash Grove in, 66, with Bob Warford on the banjo,
yeah,
and
right,
Eric
right.
was playing the
bass.
The bass.
First time I saw them, we had a little band, and me and Herb Peterson and a couple other guys, and we went down to Los Angeles and make it in the music business, you know. Yeah, the first gig we had was on this, what's that station in San Diego? Hugh Cherry? Remember that show?
Oh, yeah, Hugh Cherry.
Yeah, and we saw Roland Clarence, and our socks were rolling up and down, you know.
Anyway. Oh, it was the Dodge dealer.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah, Cal Worthington Dodge.
It was like a one-day festival, though. There were several bands.
Oh, a festival? Yeah. Oh, I don't know what that was. I'll forget. It's been too long.
Well, then you went on. You played guitar with Bill Monroe for a few years?
Yeah, he came out in 1967, and he came out there with Doug Green as a guitar player. And, well, first he came out. He called Ed Pearl of the Ash Grove. He says, you know what? I'm going to fly to Los Angeles, and I'm going to bring my new fiddler with me, but I can't bring the whole band. They're going to stay with the bus. It broke down in Dallas or Fort Worth. He says, and that's how we got to call it the Bluegrass Breakdown. Anyway, so he called Ed Pearl. He says, I'm going to bring my fiddler. He says, yeah. And we met on before. He'd been to the house, my mom's house before that, a couple of times. She'd fix dinner for all of them when they come over and eat. Anyways, she says, how about them white boys? He says, could I get that guitar player? And she says, well, I'll call Roland and see. And so he called me up. And this is 1967, we disbanded, but Clarence was getting a lot of session work. Anyway, so I called Clarence up. I says, you want to do this? He says, no. You know, he says, I don't sing the lead to all the songs. You know all the songs. He says, you know how to do a G run? You take the job. And so I call my brother Eric. And he says, yeah, I'd love to do it, you know. And then let's see. Who else? I forgot who else we got. Oh, Eric bass and me guitar. And
which fiddle player do you do?
You know, we still don't know.
Really?
We still don't know. I just don't remember who the fiddler was. Oh, no, Byron. He brought Byron with him. I'm sorry. Yeah. Anyway, so the banjo player is what, it's a mystery, you know. And some people said it was Ry Cooter, because he did play the banjo. I called him up one time and I asked him, I said, did you play the banjo with Bill Monroe when he first came out there? He says, well, I would admit it if I did. You know? I said, well, I need an answer, you know. And some people say it was Doug Dillon, so I don't know. So, anyways, so I left Nashville and went to, I left California, went to Nashville that very week. Lamar Greer was playing the band. When they got there, the whole band got there, and it was Doug Green, of Ranger Doug, and James Monroe on the bass, and Coach Byron and Bill and me, and Doug Green was going to the University of Michigan at the time, and they asked him, he had some time off, or took time off to help Bill out, okay? So anyway, they got there on a Friday night, I think it was, and we played a Friday afternoon, so we played the show. Bill Monroe says, you boys, I'm going to settle up with you tonight. And he says, Roland, you stay on. I says, well, you have a mandolin, you have a guitar player. He says, no, but we need some help. So I stayed on, and Lamar Greer told me, he says, Roland, he says, you know, when we get back to Nashville, this guitar player is going back to the University of Michigan. He says, we're going to need a guitar player. You know, you ought to ask Bill for the job. So I told Bill, I says, well, I mean, I did this week with you. You know what I can do, and I don't know if it's good enough or not, but I could get better if I was a bluegrass boy. He says, well, I'll go talk to the boys. And went to the dressing room and talked to them, and he came out and says, okay, you're on.
That's great.
That's it. I've been in Nashville ever since.
Thank you for being out here again. It's so wonderful to see you. You know, and we could spend the whole hour in any one of these folks easily. We've got to move on.
Yes.
So we're moving on to the young buck, Chris Henry. And I hope you saw his set so far. Absolutely wonderful band, Chris Henry and the Hardcore Grass, is that what you call it? Yes, indeed. And he's been he's one of my road buddies that joined the Peter Rowan Bluegrass Band recently, too. And we'll do some more music before we go, but I just... Your background, I don't know that much because you're just coming out with is this your first band as a leader?
It is, yeah. My folks, Red Murphy Henry, they played bluegrass and they had a band in Florida from about 75 to 85. And my dad's a great Monroe-style mandolin player. I kind of think of him as like Monroe on crack or steroids or something like that in a way. And plays real hard and real fast and aggressive and all that. And my mom's a great banjo picker, and so they make their living like how to play bluegrass by ear. Started out audio cassettes and then videos and now DVDs and all that. So I was kind of around the music in that way, and I remember their band, they played a lot of up-tempo stuff. So I wanted to learn how to play really fast and like, you know, the neck break on Rawhide and that kind of stuff. And I kind of have a lot of the, you know, I know, youthful, declining a little bit in my mid-30s now, but just playing, you know, P and V with the speed and velocity and just kind of playing as hard as I can, and I find that to be really enjoyable.
Could you hold up your mandolin and show the lower F hole there? Am I seeing this correctly? Because my age, I don't see that well. Is that, did you wear all that out?
I think my dad did a lot of it, but I kind of re-wore it out.
Okay.
I don't know.
Sorry to interrupt.
No worries.
Yeah, well, we noticed that style of playing is really exciting to me.
Yeah, and I was lucky to grow up with my dad was a great mandolin player, and then David McLaughlin, who was with Johnson Mountain Boys, he also lived there in Winchester, and so I had two great but very similar but very different major influences there. David's probably perhaps the cleanest of the Monroe-style players, and he just plays beautifully, like, just about as precise as you could get. And then my dad, on the other hand, was like, just going for the world is ending kind of sound.
Armageddon.
and so I kind of pick up where he leaves off a little bit, and then came to Nashville about 10 years ago, and played with various kind of blue-collar bluegrass bands, and then was happy to get into Peter Rowan's bluegrass band the last few years, and that's where we got to know each other and everything. And
well, I think we're going to hear a lot of Chris Henry in this band, and don't miss this. You another set to play here?
No, we're done.
Oh, well.
Catch us in the campground.
Catch him at the next
2:30 in the morning.
Oh, that's wonderful. We're getting low on time. Yeah, of course, the universal influence here for a bluegrass festival and for all
he's
going to
play one, yeah.
Well, we're all going to play one.
Can we do a blues?
Well, sure.
Is that
go
cool?
Ahead. And then we'll maybe end on a Monroe tune. So
cool.
That makes some sense.
How's the, let's just do a little blues.
good idea, Chris Henry.
One more.
You tell us.
Well, I want everybody involved in it. I mean, maybe just a...
We got any requests?
Yeah.
Pike County Breakdown. Where it all started for Roland. He's the oldest one here, I believe. I'm trying to catch him.
Well, go ahead. Whatever you got, if you want to do, do it. And I'll thank you now, because we'll run out of time. Thanks so much for taking part of this special event. These are all really, really super nice folks. So if you get a chance to go to a record table somewhere and buy something from them and say hi, please do.
Request to sign his bandolin. All right, 1, 2, 3.
Thank you guys so much. Thank you very much.